Welcome to Time to Talk. I'm Argie Holliman, and today is April 24th, 2019. And we are so glad that you could join us once again. Today was another beautiful, sunshiny day. We appreciate that so much, because someone has said the bad word that starts with an S and ends with a W about snow, and that's going to come back again pretty soon. But we're just going to enjoy what we have while we have it. And it's nice just to see the sunshine, to see the grass, and we appreciate that so much. Today for our show, we have open forum. That's an open topic, means our phones are going to be open for the entire hour that we have, and you're going to determine what the topics are and what you would like to share, what's been on your mind, what would you like to talk about. You know, so often you see different people and different topics on TV, and you're yelling at the TV, but nobody is hearing you except maybe, you know, your cat or your dog or people around the house who sometimes have stopped listening to you. So, but this is your opportunity to share your thoughts, your feelings, your issues, your concerns. Our live call-in number is 616-459-4881. That's 616-459-4881. You know, if you've been in Grand Rapids any amount of time, you're seeing how things are changing here in our city. There is a lot of growth, a lot of growth, and a lot of people. It's like, whoa, where did all these people come from? But they're coming from all over, getting some really good jobs, and they need housing. And it's not enough housing. And they're trying to build housing just as fast as they can. But many times it's often very expensive. But if you have those good jobs, then you can afford it. Well, what happens to those who can't afford it and then get moved out of where they were? And then where do they go? What do they do? Because then the rates are so high. People who own real estate know, hey, I'm renting this place and this is how much it costs, $1,000, $1,200, $1,500, whatever the market costs for. If people are going to pay it, people are going to demand that it's paid. And so that leaves out a lot of affordable housing. And that's a word that kind of gets tossed around a lot, that, yeah, we're going to make sure there's affordable housing. Affordable for who? What does that mean exactly? Is it affordable, or is it low income housing, or do the people with the low income just kind of get left out? It kind of seems like they get left out right about now. also, things that have changed quite a bit is the traffic. Oh my goodness. Oh, everybody has a car, okay? And there's cars everywhere in Grand Rapids. And I'm sorry, not everybody knows how to drive, okay? And not everybody is courteous, and it can, you know, take you through a lot of panic, especially driving downtown in the afternoon. Oh my goodness, maybe even early in the morning too. But it's a lot of traffic, a lot of traffic. And people aren't always as courteous. Sometimes they are, you know, but you got to get in where you fit in. And there are a lot of cars. And I'm wondering, where are all these people going to park? You know, there still isn't enough parking. And now the parking has gone up as well. And it's a lot of growth here in Grand Rapids. And that's very interesting. excuse me. Some of the things about some of the high-rise, pretty much I would call them, buildings is, if I lived next to those or near those, they don't care anything about blocking somebody's sun. It's like maybe you used to look out your window and see this gorgeous sunrise or gorgeous sunset or just see the sun. Now there's a big building blocking your window. And I often wonder about how do people feel about that, that just all of a sudden there wasn't a building in front of you or next door to you, and now there is one, and you don't get to enjoy your sun. I like sun, so that would be an issue for me, is that you got to pay all this money and you don't get to see the sun. Not good. So let's talk about some of the things that are going on today, and then anything that you want to talk about, we'll talk about that too. 616-459-4881. You know, there is a new, it's not a new policy yet, but proposed, yes, it's proposed, about people calling the Grand Rapids Police Department and, in a sense, race baiting the police and saying this person is of such and such a race, is doing such and such a thing, and not for the description only, but just to kind of get the police to come, just because the person is there. You know, maybe they're just sitting on their porch, and then you're gonna call, somebody's gonna call and say, well, they're committing a crime or something, when no crime has been committed. Of course, when a crime has been committed, then yeah, you give a description, the police want a description and things like that. But the police resources already are limited. So the police don't want people calling just because, you know, your racism has risen to the top, you know? So they don't want that. They don't want that. They want legitimate cause. And then what they want is, if people keep doing that, like I've seen in different cities where, okay, say an African-American student is studying in the library, you know, and somebody calls the police and says they're committing a crime by being there. No, that doesn't make sense. And so the proposal is to arrest people who do that and call the police unnecessarily, and there is really no issue. When the police come and get to the bottom of it, there really is no issue. So that is not a good thing. And there was a Grand Rapids City Commission meeting yesterday, April 23rd, 2019. And people, they wanted to hear from the public on whatever side, you know, whatever side you're on regarding that issue, they wanted to hear about it to see what should they do, the city commission, what should the Grand Rapids Police Department do, if anything, and how to handle this particular issue. Because we all have to live together, one way or another. We have to live together and kind of find a way to do that. So if you were at that meeting, or if you have a thought about it, maybe you didn't get to go, but maybe you have a thought about it, give us a call, 616-459-4881. Yes, 616-459-4881. Open mic today, your chance to talk. It's time to talk. We haven't done this in a long time. I've been doing this now 30 years. Can you believe it? 30 years. And we kind of used to do this all the time. It was kind of have an open phone line, let you say what you want to say, share it with the community. And maybe it's something that we can all benefit from. And so open concept is our topic today. So since we're kind of talking about the police and everything, and issues with the police and the community. Let's talk about something that we're hearing more and more about is complaints regarding the police department, the Grand Rapids Police Department. And this is this was really handy. This is a citizen complaint procedure. Very simple brochure. I got it from the Grand Rapids Public Library. You know, our libraries are amazing. They're just a wealth of information. There's so much information there. We pay taxes for our libraries, and our libraries are, I believe, pretty much up to date and have so much information there, you know, written and audio and online and the classes that they have that you can come and take free of charge. Wonderful resource. So I got this from the Grand Rapids Public Library, and this is about citizen complaint procedure. So let's go over that a little bit. Because when you have what you feel is a legitimate complaint, then there's a certain way you need to handle that. And then so that you can get a response that you need, okay? So now who may register a complaint? Any person may register a complaint against any employee of the Grand Rapids Police Department. Complainants are encouraged to appear in person. However, complaints also may be received by telephone, fax, internet, through the mail, and the mailing address is Grand Rapids Police Department, 1 Monroe Center Northwest, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 49503. And that information is on the screen for you as well, and we'll continue to put that up as we go along. Okay, no complaint will be received by any employee of the Grand Rapids Police Department except those assigned to the Internal Affairs Unit located at 1 Monroe Center Northwest. The telephone number is 616-456-3480. The fax number is 616-456-3232. The office hours are 8 to 5, Monday through Friday. The city attorney or the labor relations director may also receive complaints. All complaints against the Grand Rapids Police Department or its employees shall receive an appropriate, thorough, and objective investigation. So they're saying just don't give it to anybody. Make sure you take it to the right department, which is either Internal Affairs or the city attorney or the labor relations director. All of those people can receive complaints. You give it to somebody else, not in those positions, where do you think that might wind up? Poof, in the trash. Okay, maybe. But at least you want to follow procedures. Everything has a procedure, so you want to make sure you're following the procedure. And these are the procedures. Now, here you go with the complaint procedure. Many complaints can be satisfactorily resolved by a visit or a phone call to the Grand Rapids Police Department. However, the Internal Affairs Unit will complete an appropriate and thorough investigation for complaints that cannot be satisfactorily resolved. All complaints receive an appropriate, thorough, and objective investigation, which may include interviews with the complainant, the named employees, and known witnesses. This isn't here, but I would say that it's important to be as detailed as possible with your complaint. You know, you want to be as clear as possible. Write it out before you file the complaint. Write it out so that you can organize your thoughts, because maybe whatever happened, you know, has you very angry, very upset, very disappointed, and you just want to fly off the handle, and then that's not going to get you anywhere. You want to be specific. You want to give names, who, what, when, where, what happened, why, in your opinion. Be as detailed as possible. Write it out for yourself. Then write it out again. Read it. And then if you can, you know, type it. Type it if you can, so that it will be legible. You don't have to do those things, but I think it would help. Okay. Complaints regarding allegations of minor rule or policy violations may be assigned to the employee's supervisor for investigation and disposition. At the conclusion of the investigation, the employee's supervisor will contact the complainant by telephone or in person to advise them of the disposition of their complaint. If you're just tuning in, we're talking about how to file a complaint with the Grand Rapids Police and the Internal Affairs Unit. And this information is coming from this brochure that is published by the Grand Rapids Police Department. So it should be accurate. Okay, so complaints regarding allegations of major rule or policy violations will result in the preparation of a complaint intake report, which contains a summary of the allegations that have been received for investigation. After a complaint is fully and properly investigated, the Internal Affairs Unit will render a disposition based on the established facts and circumstances. This disposition, along with its supporting information, will be included in the complaint disposition report. So you should be getting a copy of these things in writing. And also, maybe when you file the complaint, you can ask, when could I expect to hear back from you initially? And then when you do, you know, well, what's the next step? What's going to happen next? Stay in touch. Stay on top of it. Don't let it go. If it was serious enough to file a complaint, it's serious enough to follow up on. And that's for everyone's benefit, for your own benefit, and to also help our police department when there are issues, to address those issues and make it better, because the police are there to protect and serve. So that should help them to do their job when they are made aware of something that needs to be changed or addressed. Okay. Once completed, the complaint disposition report is delivered to the Office of the Chief of Police for final action. The Internal Affairs Unit will provide written notice to both the complainant and the employee of the final disposition of an Internal Affairs Unit investigation and provide each with an opportunity to discuss the disposition. For those complaints that fall within the scope of the Grand Rapids Police Civilian Appeal Board, instructions for filing an appeal of the Internal Affairs Unit findings will be included with the complaint disposition mailing, report mailing. This policy is detailed on the reverse side of this page. And it is quite detailed. So you want to definitely get a copy of this. Okay. Let's see. Additional information regarding the role and authority of the Civilian Appeal Board may be obtained by contacting the City of Grand Rapids City Attorney's Office, 300 Monroe Avenue, Northwest, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 49503. We're just covering different topics here today. We have open concept. Right now, we're talking about how to make a complaint to the Grand Rapids Police Department Internal Affairs Unit. Sometimes we want to make complaints to each other which, okay, yeah, we need to talk about it, but if you want something done about it, you got to tell the people who you have an issue with, and at least get that registered as a complaint, because you might feel like, oh, they're not going to do anything, and maybe not, but it's important to get these things registered, because one day that's coming back again. Okay, it is the policy of the Grand Rapids Police Department to investigate and resolve all allegations of employee misconduct. The goal of the Internal Affairs Unit is to maintain the integrity of the Grand Rapids Police Department through an operation of a competent, objective, fair, and impartial internal investigation and review system. Police officers must be free to exercise their best judgment and to initiate action in a reasonable, lawful, impartial manner without the fear of reprisal. At the same time, the rights of all individuals must be observed. This system of complaint and disciplinary procedures not only subjects department employees to corrective action when they conduct themselves improperly, but also protects them from unwarranted criticism when they discharge their duties in a professional, proper manner. Okay. Although the employee's name in a complaint may at some point be required to respond to the specific allegations made, they are not permitted access to the files of cases under investigations. So they can't go looking through the file and say, you told on me. I got something for you. Can't do that. They can't do that. Not supposed to do that. Complainants who have current criminal or traffic charges pending in an incident should be aware that the internal investigation process deals solely with matters of department policy and the conduct of its employees. Regardless of the outcome of the internal investigation, existing criminal or traffic charges must still be processed through the court system. So they can't turn around and say, well, you have a warrant anyway, so we're going to get you for that, or you have a traffic violations and tickets, and we're going to get you for that. No, they have to go through, those are separate issues, and they still have to go through the court system. The Internal Affairs Unit is sensitive to the anxiety some complainants may feel with making a complaint against a department employee. You know, people might be very afraid, like, what's going to happen to me now that I made this complaint? Are they going to retaliate against me? To that end, special arrangements may be considered by investigators in establishing alternate locations for complainant interviews. Now, there's the other issue of undocumented residents being afraid to report any violations or complaints that they may have for fear of being deported. So they don't want, many times, any interaction with police at all, and may be very afraid to report behavior that wasn't legal or appropriate. If you are an undocumented resident, we will not report you. This is the Grand Rapids Police saying this. We will not report you to the Office of U.S. Citizenship and Naturalization Services, formerly the Department of Immigration and Naturalization Services, INS, and now it's ICE, unless you have been convicted of a certain felony criminal offenses. We want to hear, says the Grand Rapids Police, from all community members. Okay, here are the dispositions. Okay, so you made the complaint, you filed it, You went through all the procedures that you know to do. And then here are some possible dispositions to your complaint. One, it could be considered unfounded. The investigation conclusively proved that the act or acts complained of did not occur. This finding also applies when the act or acts may have occurred, but the named employees were not involved. The next one is exonerated. This means the act which provided the basis for the complaint or allegation did occur. However, investigation revealed that it was justified, lawful, and proper. The next one, not sustained. Investigation failed to disclose sufficient evidence to clearly prove the allegation made in the complaint or to conclusively disprove such allegation. The last one is sustained. The investigation disclosed sufficient evidence to clearly prove the allegation that was made in the complaint. Violation of policy and or procedure did occur, and appropriate administrative action will be taken. There are five types of action which can be recommended for a sustained case. These five actions are: one, training; two, counseling; three, written reprimand; four, suspension without pay; or five, discharge from the department. Sworn police officers and civil employees may appeal written reprimands, suspensions, and discharges from the department. And then there's also a Grand Rapids Police Department Civilian Appeal Board. This is made up of civilians, so that you can take it to people who are not wearing blue, wearing the blue, so that, you know, maybe they have a different outlook on things. So, and then they also go through all of the different steps again, just to make sure that your rights are ensured. So if you have a complaint regarding the Grand Rapids Police Department, then be sure to write it out and send that to them. And you do have to be specific. So that would go to the Internal Affairs Unit, Grand Rapids Police Department, 1 Monroe Center Northwest, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 49503. The office is, the office number 616-456-3480. The fax number is 456-3282. And they're open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. And you can also turn in your complaint to the city attorney or the labor relations director. And I would suggest that anything that you do, that you document that. If you send a letter, send a fax, write down the date, the time. If you call somebody, write down everybody that you talk to, okay? And then what did they say, okay? And if they ask you to do something, be sure to do it so that you can't, no one can say you didn't follow instructions. You're watching Time to Talk today, and we just have an open forum. And our number is 616-459-4881. And if you have something you would like to talk about, it doesn't have to be about the police or anything. It can be whatever. Whatever is on your mind. And give us a call. 616-459-4881. When we come back, we're going to talk about some jobs that are coming up and going to be available for you very, very soon. Some good paying jobs too. So I know you want to know about that, or you might have a friend, a relative, or somebody always borrowing money from you. Oh, no, excuse me. Okay, that's something else. Okay, but they need a job, or maybe you need a job. So, okay, we're going to find out some more about these jobs after our break. We want to remind you that you can watch Time to Talk every second and fourth Wednesday, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. on GRTV, Comcast Cable 25. And if you don't have Comcast anymore, or go to a friend's house to watch Time to Talk, you can see it on the internet too. We'll put that information up for you, Time to Talk TV, and live access, and you know, it's kind of long, but we'll get it up there for you so you can watch on the internet, and then you can go back on YouTube after the show is over, and then check out what you missed, all those shows that you missed. Because we only have about maybe four, I think, shows left for the season. Our season goes from the second week in September to the second week in June. And you know that June show is always my birthday bash. So we're going to have a great time with some musical guests for that. You don't want to miss it. Let's go to a break right now. And when we come back, let me hear from you. 616-459-4881. 616-459-4881. You're watching Time to Talk with our open forum today. We'll be right back. Hello, welcome back to Time to Talk. I'm Argie Holliman, and I'm glad that you could join us once again. As I said before our break, we're here every second and fourth Wednesday, live, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. Of course, you can see our reruns on Friday at 11:30 in the morning, and Saturday, this is the following week of the live show, okay? Friday and Saturday. Friday at 11:30 a.m., Saturday at 12:30 p.m. here on GRTV, Comcast Cable 25. Then, for our friends in Wyoming, Kentwood, Gaines Township, you can see it on Comcast Cable 25 out in that area every Wednesday. They're repeats, but it's every Wednesday, 2:30 p.m. and 8 p.m. So don't miss it. Don't miss Time to Talk. And you can see it on the internet and on YouTube. So go back and get all those shows that you missed. Of course, now, when you go back and look at the previous shows, you can't call in. But when we're live, and when I say we're live, and you can call in, and our call-in number is 616-459-4881, that means you can call in when you look on the calendar and see that the dates match up, or look on your phone and see that the dates match up, then yes, you can call. So then you don't have to wait till you see me in the grocery store and say, you know what, Argie, I just had a question, and oh man, it was such a good question, and I didn't get to ask it because I was just sitting there looking, which I'm glad you're looking. But if you want to answer to a question or you want to say something when we're live, then that's that time to be able to do that. And I can't think of any shows where you can do that. So, but you can do that right here at Time to Talk. Let's move on to something else. I said we were going to talk about some jobs, okay? And maybe you need one, maybe somebody you know need one, or you need another. Maybe you got two, three, four jobs mount, okay? But you need another one, okay? Well, let me tell you, the census is hiring, The 2020 census, it's time for that again. You know, that census, the U.S. census, is taken every 10 years, right? Okay, and so it's really important. The census gives the government a lot of information that they use to make decisions. They find out things about, you know, how old people are, male, female, different things like that. Business and economy, what businesses are growing. This may help you if you want to start a business, or you're a young person that's trying to decide what field to go into, or even an older person too. Education, what resources are needed, emergency preparedness, all this stuff comes out of the census as to how much money are we going to put and where are we going to put it at? Employment, families and living arrangements. How are people living? You know, single people, families, children, you know, 20 people in a house. No, never mind. Okay. Geographic mobility, geography, health, origin, you know, people coming from other places, housing. Income and poverty, you know, has that level moved? Where is it? What's the poverty level now? International trade, population estimates, the public sector, race, research, voting and registration, all this stuff gets collected from the census. So they need census takers. So let's answer a few questions, and if maybe you have some more, give us a call, 616-459-4881. I'm not an expert on it. I don't work for them, but I have this information. that I got from the Grand Rapids Public Library. And you can get it online too. And the library also has access to the internet for you. If you don't have access, you can go down there and use their computers and other things like printers and faxes and many other things like that, low cost. And I think you can get the Kindles and different things like that too. Okay, so why should someone choose to work as a census taker? Census positions provide the perfect opportunity to earn extra income while helping your community. The results of the 2020 census will help determine your state's representation in Congress, as well as how certain funds are spent for schools, hospital, roads, and more. This is your chance to play a part in history and help ensure that everyone in your community is counted. What are the benefits of working as a census taker? In addition to supporting your community, census jobs offer great pay every week. Getting paid every week? Oh, okay. Where do I sign up? Oh, okay. Flexible hours and paid training. So they show you how to do it. It's very flexible. You can work days, evenings, weekends. Let's see. How does someone apply for a 2020 census job? These jobs are needed everywhere, everywhere, every city, every county, everywhere, all over the United States. In addition to supporting your community, census jobs offer great pay every week, flexible hours, and paid training. Okay, I said that. Applying is easy. Here we go. We're going to put this on the screen for you. Visit 2020census.gov/jobs, J-O-B-S, to learn more, then click on Apply Now. Potential applicants can also call 1-855-JOB-2020, which is 562-2020, or use the Federal Relay Service at 800-877-8339 for TTYASC11 to learn more or for assistance. What are the application requirements? Well, I'm glad you asked. That is a good question. Okay. Applying is easy. Visit 2020census, census is census.gov, /jobs, J-O-B-S, to learn more. Then click on Apply Now. Potential, okay. Applicants can also call 1-855-JOB-2020. Okay, like we just said. Now, who can apply for this? Probably you. People can apply for 2020 census work if they are at least 18 years old, a U.S. citizen, and if they have a valid Social Security number, not one that was written in crayon. No, that is not going to work. You need a valid Social Security number. And email address. You do need an email address. And you can get an email address many times free, you know. So, now males, listen, males born after December 31st, 1959 must also be registered with the Selective Service System or have a qualifying exemption that says why you have not registered as a male that was born after 1959 with the Selective Service System. That system is in place, okay? And they want to make sure that you've taken care of that little piece of business. Please visit 2020census.gov/jobs to learn more about specific application requirements. When someone does apply for a 2020 census job, what kind of questions are asked? As part of the application process, applicants will be asked questions related to their educational, work, and other experiences. You know, just like any other job, they want to know a little bit about you, your experience, what have you done before. You don't necessarily have to have been a census taker before, but they want to know a little bit about you and your background and so on. And are you suited for this work? What happens once someone is offered a 2020 census job? Potential employees must pass a criminal background check. Whoop, there it is. And review of criminal records, including fingerprinting. But I know you're good on that. I know you're good. Once these steps are completed, potential employees will receive information about training. What is required of most 2020 census employees? Employees should have access to a vehicle and a valid driver's license unless public transportation is readily available. So employees should also have access to an internet-connected computer to complete the training process. What can people expect their 2020 census work schedule to be like? Work schedules depend on individual positions. Generally, hours for field positions are flexible. Some positions require work during the day, and other positions require evening and weekend work, interviewing the public. In addition, supervisory positions require employees to be available for certain day, evening, and or weekend shifts if you're a supervisor. Where will most people work? The Census Bureau is committed to hiring census takers to work in their own communities. So places that you're familiar with, maybe people that you're familiar with, where you feel most comfortable. How often will 2020 census employees be paid? We're talking about these jobs that are coming up. You want to apply now, even though we're talking about 2020. They're going to have everything in place before that time. So how often will 2020 census employees be paid? Employees are paid weekly. Every week you're getting some money there and can expect to receive their first paycheck approximately 10 to 14 days after their first day of work. Now, let's talk about work skills and things like that. Now, just because you get that first check doesn't mean now I quit. I'm done. No, you know, stay on the job. If you're going to be committed to it, go ahead and finish out your term with it. It's not going to be so long anyway, but that'll be good. Yeah, see, that's true on any job. Just don't stay till the first paycheck and then you're out of there. No, stay. Honor your commitment, okay? Will 2020 census employees be reimbursed for work-related expenses? Field employees will be reimbursed for authorized work expenses like mileage while conducting 2020 census work. Now, it must be census work, okay? Can't just be that you and your friend went to lunch and, hey, I was asking them some census question. Nope, it's got to be work related. Got to be able to document that. Okay. Will 2020 census employees be paid during the training? Well, yes, they will. 2020 census employees will be paid during training at a slightly lower rate than their regular hour rate. Okay. And then I have a question for you. Let's get you on the internet, going through some skills or something, see if who's the first person can call me back with this answer of how much will the 2020 census pay for a field worker. The question is, go online and tell me what will the census, U.S. Census Bureau, pay for a 2020 field worker. Then call me at 616-459-4881, 456-459-4881. And then we'll think of something to give you. What kind of prize? Some kind of prize. We'll think of something. It'll be nice, something. But let's see. And you can go to U.S. Census. Let's see, where will the answer be? At U.S. Census, no, go 2020census.gov/jobs, okay? 2020census, C-E-N-S-U-S, .gov/jobs. First person call me back with how much are they paying for a field worker for the 2020 census. And this right here says it's great pay, flexible hours, weekly pay, paid training, okay? Phone number, if you're not on the web or have access to it right now, is 1-855-JOB-2020. Great way to get some exercise too, because I'm sure there is a lot of walking involved in that. And a lot of listening to people and meeting people and getting some very important work done, for our nation. So again, the application requirements are be 18 years old, a U.S. citizen, have a valid Social Security number and email address. Males who are born after December 31st, 1959 must also be registered with the Selective Service System or have a qualifying exemption as to why they haven't registered and prove documentation of that as well. And please visit 2020census.gov/jobs to learn more about specific application requirements, okay? And they will ask you about your work background, and maybe, I don't know if they give you choices as to where you want to work, but I think they do try to put you in the communities where you live. And so for citizens or residents, when the census does come, we'll get proof that they're from the census. You know, they should have ID and everything like that. But answer the questions. These are important. They're important for the resources. You know, representatives are, that's one of the ways they decide how many representatives you're gonna get, you know, in a particular area. If you only have 10, 20 people living there, you're not gonna get that many representatives, okay? But if you have a large area and we can get everybody accounted for, that's important, so that we can get that representation and get an accurate count and get some resources. Money is allocated based on the census. Money, money. And we need more money in the community. Yes, yes. And for the things that we are concerned about. What are we concerned about? Healthcare, housing, jobs, crime prevention, all of that. All of it takes money. So we want to be sure to get that U.S. Census taken care of. And there was also some controversy. We don't have time to talk about that today with people, some people saying, well, there's certain questions we don't want on that census because it's going to make undocumented immigrants afraid of being deported and things like that. And so that's a legitimate concern. So the Supreme Court's going to be looking at that. And then, you know, I don't want to say illegal aliens. To me, nobody's an alien. You know, an alien is something comes out of space or something like that. But people are undocumented immigrants. So I think that's a better term. I want to thank you so much for listening and hopefully learning something. And when you learn something, it's really important to share it with somebody else. And and let me share this with you. GRTV here, the Community Media Center, this is for the public. This is public access. You know what that means? That means that you could come and be sitting right here and doing a show about what you feel is important, and sharing it with people, whatever it might be. And we want to see you again in 2 weeks, if the Lord says so. We will see you in May for our Mother's Day show. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Argie Holliman. Bye-bye.